A Lough Neagh sequence. Up the shore. The loch will claim a victim every year. It has virtue that hardens wood to stone. There is a town sunk beneath its water. It is the scar left by the Isle of Man. A tomb bridge where it sluices towards the sea. They've set new gates and tanks against the flow. From time to time they break the eel's journey and lift 500 stone in one go. But up the shore in Antrim and Tyrone, there is a sense of fair play in the game. The fishermen confront them one by one and sail miles out and never learn to swim. "We'll be the quicker going down," they say. And when you argue there are no storms here, that 1 hour floating's sure to land them safely, the loch will claim a victim every year. Beyond Sargasso. A gland agitating mud 200 miles inland, a scale of water on water working up estuaries, he drifted into motion halfway across the Atlantic, sure as a satellite's insinuating pull in the ocean, as true to his orbit. Against ebb, current, rock, rapids, a muscled icicle that melts itself longer and fatter, he buries his arrival beyond light and tidal water, investing silt and sand with a sleek root. By day, only the drainmaker's spade or the mud paddler can make him abort. Dark delivers him hungering down each undulation. Bait. Lamps dawdle in the field at midnight. 3 men follow their nose in the grass. The lamps beam their prow and compass. The bucket's handle better not clatter now. Silence and curious light gather bait. Nab him, but wait for the first shrinking, tacky on the thumb. Let him resettle backwards in his tunnel, then draw steady, and he'll come. Among the millions whirling their mud coronas, under dewlap leaf and bowed blades, a few are bound to be rustled in these night raids. Innocent ventilators of the ground, making the globe a perfect fit, a few are bound to be cheated of it when lamps dawdle in the field at midnight, when fishers need a garland for the bay and have him where he needs to come, out of the clay. Setting. A line goes out of sight and out of mind, down to a soft bottom of silt and sand, past the indifferent skill of the hunting hand. A bouquet of small hooks coiled in the stern is being paid out back to its true form until the bouquet is hidden in the worm. The boat rides forward where the line slants back. The oars in their locks go round and round. The eel describes his arcs without a sound. The gulls fly an umbrella overhead, treading air as soon as the line runs out, responsive acolytes above the boat. Not sensible of any Kyrie, the fishers, who don't know and never try, pursue the work in hand as destiny. They clear the bucket of the last chopped worms pitching them high. Good riddance, earthy char. The gulls encompass them before the water. Lifting. They're busy in a high boat that stalks towards Antrim, the power cut. The line's a filament of smut drawn hand over fist, where every 3 yards a hook's missed or taken, and the smut thickens wrist thick, a flail lashed into the barrel with one swing. Each eel comes aboard to this welcome. The hook left in gill or gum, it's slapped into the barrel numb, but knits itself 4-ply with the furling, fat, slippy haul, and knot of back and pewter belly that stays continuously won, for each catch they fling in is sucked home like lubrication, and wakes are inwound as the catch on the morning water. Which boat was which? And when did this begin? This morning? Last year? When the loch first spawned? The crews will answer once the season's in. The return. In ponds, drains, dead canals, she turns her head back. Older now, following whim deliberately, till she's at sea in grass, and damned if she'll turn, so it's new trenches, sunk pipes, swamps, running streams, the loch, the river. Her stomach shrunk, she exhilarates in mid-water. Its throbbing is speed through days and weeks. Who knows now if she knows her depth or direction? She's past Mallan and Torrey, silent, wakeless, a wisp, a wick that is its own taper and light through the weltering dark. Where she's lost, once she lays 10,000 feet down in her origins. The current carries slicks of orphaned spawn. Vision. Unless his hair was fine combed, the lice, they said, would gang up into a mealy rope and drag him, small, dirty, doomed, down to the water. He was cautious then in riverbank fields. Thick as a birch trunk, that cable flexed in the grass every time the wind passed. Years later, in the same fields, he stood at night when eels moved through the grass like hatched fears towards the water, to stand in one place as the field flowed past a jellied road, to watch the eels crossing land, rewound his world's live girdle. Phosphorescent sinewed slime continued at his feet. Time confirmed the horrid